Skip says that Stephen A's bad man was just bad last year, but according to ESPN's Football Outsiders, he will be very good this season. So let's get into it. Green Bay is projected to win the division at 12-4, with the Vikings and Lions finishing three games behind at 9-7. Stephen A, did they get it right about your boy and his team?
Of course they did. I mean, there's nothing to talk about here. I mean, first of all, Chicago has Jay Cutler as their quarterback. Enough said. The Lions are in flux. I don't know if they'll win five games this year. I know they won seven last year coming on strong, but I thought it was a bit fluky with Megatron having retired and Golden Tate is your primary option. I'm just not sure about that right now, even though Amir Abdullah is somebody that I find impressive, but I think he's an undersized running back in terms of durability as it pertains to how many times he'll touch the football. I'm just not sure about that. So now we go to Minnesota and Green Bay. I know Minnesota was impressive. It helped that it was freezing temperatures that assisted them because they were playing in weather in Seattle against Seattle in the playoffs that, as far as I'm concerned, even though it's football, no human being should be allowed to play in as far as I'm concerned. That's how cold it was, all right? But nevertheless, you look at a guy like Teddy Bridgewater. Adrian Peterson is an absolute stud. We know that. But Teddy Bridgewater is a relatively pedestrian quarterback. He'll keep the mistakes to a minimum. But is he a game-breaking kind of quarterback? No. And I think ultimately that's what it's going to take to upend the Green Bay Packers and Aaron Rodgers. Jordy Nelson is coming back. Eddie Lacy is no longer fat. He's lost his weight. Doesn't walk around with a pot belly looking all rotund or anything like that. He's back in shape and focused. I think he'll be better for it. Him, Jordy Nelson, Randall Cobb, Richard Rodgers is your tight end, a relatively decent offensive line. You're not going to experiment with Clay Matthews at the middle linebacker spot anymore. You're going to unleash him probably from the weak linebacker spot and make him do some damage there. I just think that when you're looking at Green Bay and you're looking at a stud like Aaron Rodgers and you recognize the fact that it's the most important position in the game, you give anybody in that position an edge in their division. But then, when you talk about Aaron Rodgers, how can you avoid saying, and say it with me, Skip, he's a bad man, okay?
Sorry.
Because he's so bad. He's so bad. Yeah. But understand this. He's so bad that 31 touchdowns, 8 interceptions, and a QBR of 64 last season actually was a down year for him. Mm-hmm. That's how bad he is. And so I look at it, and I'm saying to myself, let me get this straight. Teddy Bridgewater, Matthew Stafford, and Jay Cutler as your competition, and I'm supposed to be worried about Green Bay losing the division? Please, please, let's move on.
Well, I give you this. The receiver that made Aaron Rodgers should be back, and he should be healthy, and Jordy Nelson. So maybe Aaron will be back because Jordy's back. So before I get to my answer to Molly's question, I'm going to remind you, a few experts that I've read, people I respect, are already predicting that the Chicago Bears are going to be the breakout playoff team from this division.
Really?
Because of Jay Cutler.
Because they respect Fox.
Huh?
Because they know because of John Fox.
You know what? You
and his defense. That's why. Not Jay Cutler.
You have insulted Jay Cutler so often on this show. You know what? I think he might play with Jordan-esque rage next year to get even with you, a la Steph Curry. Yeah.
Yeah. The same sentence Cutler and Curry just said?
And Jordan.
Oh,
and
really? And Jordan.
Well, they're Chicago people. You know, it's a Chicago thing.
Don't let the facts get in the way of a good story.
Time out, Molly. Time out. Did Skip Bayless just sit up there and say Jay Cutler and the word Jordan-esque? In the same sentence?
Yeah. They both play or have played in the city of Chicago, so they have
common.
That.
Yeah,
they
that's about it.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah, really.
Jay Cutler?
Yeah.
First of all, Jay Cutler's been so bad for Chicago, they wouldn't even allow him in Michael Jordan's restaurant, let alone allow him to have Jordan-esque mentioned in the same sentence as his name. I mean, please.
Okay.
He's lucky he hasn't there ever been barricades banning him from the city of Chicago already. Yeah. He's lucky that hasn't happened.
Yeah.
Jordan-esque. Cutler.
Yeah,
oh,
we'll
that's
see.
Funny. Oh,
we'll
you're hilarious, Skip.
But I'll leave that one alone for a while, and I'll get back to the question.
You need to. Let's go.
I have tried for much of this morning before the show to make a case for the Vikings challenging the Packers in this division. And I must admit to you, I'm with you. I can't make it. I try because it's hard to disrespect 11-5. That's what Minnesota went last year. We respect the head coach. I respect the offensive coordinator, know him well, North Turner, Mike Zimmer, obviously. It's around both them in Dallas. But I'm with you. As much as I like the football team, and as much as I like the fact that Adrian Peterson at age 31 is probably as fit a 31-year-old running back as we've ever seen in the history of this league, and the fact that he did lead the league in rushing last year and probably will do it again this year, I can't discount that. And they drafted Laquon Treadwell to beef up their receiving core. That kid Stephon Diggs, that fifth-rounder they got from Maryland last year, led the team in receiving. Kyle Rudolph, Mike Wallace. So the receiver, it's going to get a little better. So the football team got a little better. They obviously, to your point, it was North Pole cold, but in that playoff game, Teddy Bridgewater was really good down the stretch. You got to give this to him. I know it was freezing cold and conditions that no human should play football in, but he led them down the field, throwing mostly to Rudolph, and got them in position, and Blair Witch Project blew the chip shot field goal, or they would have beaten Seattle in a playoff game. So that's the perspective, but I'm with you. When I watch Teddy Bridgewater, I just see the basic, and I know it's sort of damning with faint praise, but it's the game manager. He averaged 202 yards passing a game last year. His QBR was pretty good at 63, 13th best in the NFL. I just don't see 14 touchdowns, 9 interceptions being spectacular enough to eclipse the bad man with Jordy Nelson and Green Bay. Can they make the playoffs again? Could they be a wild card team? I'll give them that. But what was this, 3 games? Is that, mm-hmm, yeah, supposed games to win by 3? I could see it. I could see Green Bay winning by 3 games.
All right, I'm just looking at this.
Good.
Good.
The Bears are 7-9, I'm reading, and Vikings 9-7, mm-hmm, but the Giants, they were saying, what was it?
6-10.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. The suspect list. Yeah. Let's move
Stephen
on.
Stephen A., you better watch out for those Bears. Here they come.
Look, as long as Jay Cutler's their quarterback, I'm safe.
You think so? We'll see.
Yes. He's not a leader. I'm not talking about his ability because he can throw the football. He knows plays. He's got the talent to be a quarterback. He's not a leader.
All right.
He can't lead.
We shall see. Speaking of leaders, the Spurs season came to an end last night, but could this be the last time we see Tim Duncan and Manu Ginobili? The end of an era. We'll discuss that when we come back.
Nothing can stop me. I'm all the way up.
It was certainly a season to forget for the Cowboys, who were decimated by injuries last year. But 2016, according to ESPN's Football Outsiders, is going to be a very different story. They see Dallas running away with the division at 10-6, while the Giants, Eagles, and Redskins are all finishing at 6-10. Big D winning the East by 4 games. Skip?
Wow.
Did they get this right?
Stephen A., on a very dark day for me and my Spurs, at least there's a ray of sunlight in the future. My Cowboys are being predicted to win the NFC East by 4 games. Interesting. Now, again, 10-6 for me is a reasonable but conservative prediction for my Cowboys. That's, of course, if Romo and Dez get and stay healthy the whole year, and there will be a Zeke the Freak running behind the most dominating offensive line in all of pro football, all of which equals most explosive offense in all of pro football. So I'll go with 10-6. What I can't buy here is, even though I write off the Giants and I write off the Eagles, they're basically irrelevant to this discussion, no threats to my Cowboys, but I continue to be mystified by the lack of respect that the Washington Redskins get after they won or maybe stole last year's NFC East by winning their last 4 games, 5 of their last 6 to finish 9-7. Obviously, they had a home playoff game against Aaron Rodgers and company. They lost that 35-18. But Kirk Cousins is back. I got to give it up. He had a pretty good year. Heck, by his standards, you might say he had a very good year. And offseason-wise, can you argue with this? The biggest offseason addition any team made was Josh Norman. I think it was. That's just me. I thought the best receiver in the draft was another Josh named Doxton from TCU. They drafted him. I've always liked Sua Craven. He is a football player. They got in the second round. He will have immediate high collision impact on their defense. So they got better. Clearly they got better on defense. Maybe they got a little better on offense. And they're arch rivals to my Cowboys, so at least I think they could come within two games of my Cowboys, if not one game of my Cowboys. I respect and I fear the Washington Redskins, not so much the Eagles or certainly the Giants.
Gratuitous. Mm.
Well, I definitely think that you're right about that. I mean, I was wondering about the Washington Redskins myself, and how can anybody just simply go about the business of projecting that the Cowboys will win the division so easily? I mean, I'm of that mindset. I definitely think that the Cowboys probably would win the division. I think getting Ezekiel Elliott, elevating their running game, having that massive offensive line, getting both Tony Romo and Dez Bryant back healthy with Jason Witten as a reliable target, I think their offense will be potent. I think they will move the chains. I think they will chew up the clock, and I think they'll put the defense in a position where they can succeed due to the limited amount of time they'll have to spend on the field. But nevertheless, you still got some issues. You got some issues at corner. You got some issues in your interior. Sean Lee is going to do what he does, but what level of help is he going to have, and how are you going to get at the quarterback? These are all legitimate questions that you have to ask about the Dallas Cowboys. Mincy, DeMarcus Lawrence is going to be out for a few games. Randy Gregory and Mincy, neither of them recorded a sack last season. And so when you look at it from that perspective, you can't get at the quarterback, and this system of questions marks in your secondary, particularly with Orlando Scandrick, who was on injury reserve all year long due to his injury. Even though he's coming back now, you got to wonder what he's going to have to give you, at least initially. I expect Dallas's defense to be relatively suspect. As a result, I think that makes the NFC East highly competitive, because I don't think that the Redskins are necessarily going to fade into the twilight. Do I think they're going to be a juggernaut? No, because I don't think that Kirk Cousins is all of that. I'm really, really getting sick and tired. I told you I got sick and tired of hearing them say, "You like that? You like that?" I don't want to hear that from him. You know, you're not a winner enough yet to be saying stuff like that. He can play. He's no scrub, but he still has a lot to prove. And 1 year doesn't necessarily get it done. But in the end, he did have a pretty good year last year. You did elevate your receiving corps with the draft. You still got Garcon and DeSean Jackson. Alfred Morris is gone. I'm wondering about your running game right now, but I expect your defense to be better. So when I look at it from that perspective, I expect the Redskins and the Dallas Cowboys to be battling for supremacy in the East. I'd give the Dallas Cowboys a slight edge because their offense is that explosive. But anything can happen when it comes to them compared to the Redskins. So I don't understand for the life of me how the Redskins are so summarily dismissed, and everybody wants to elevate the Giants and, of course, the Philadelphia Eagles, especially the Eagles. I mean, right now, I don't see any reason to believe why the Eagles won't come in last place in the NFC East.
I agree. Which brings us back to the New York Football Giants. Would you agree it does not bode well for one GM Jerry Reese that this prediction has them finishing 6-10 after almost $200 million was spent on three free agents? What's that guy's name? Vernon Olivier. What's his name?
Yeah,
one of those guys.
Yeah, George Jenkins. That's right. That's right.
Damon Harrison. I can't remember. What's the coach's name again? The guy.
Ben McAdoo.
Ben McAdoo.
I don't think Jerry Reese is concerned about ESPN football outsiders, to be honest with you.
Well, not just that. No, he shouldn't be. And here's why, Skip, because usually when the Giants have been most successful in recent memory, it was when these predictions have been made. So if I'm Jerry Reese, I'm happy about the gloom and doom predictions, because that's usually when the Giants have excelled. And that's why he survived so long, because when people have counted them out and summarily dismissed the Giants is when they've stepped up and responded and ultimately won two Super Bowl titles. Not one, but two. So if you're Jerry Reese, you get to fall back on that and say, paid no attention to the prognosticators, because what do they mean? What do they know? They predicted this, they predicted that, and it didn't work effectively against us. It's when people are quiet or have expectations for the Giants that Jerry Reese and the Giants need to be concerned, because it's rare that they've lived up to them. But they usually live up, they usually knock down prognosticators with their negativity. When people assume that the Giants are going to stink, it's when they don't.
I'm going to assume they're going to stink. And I'm also going to point out those three free agents, almost $200 million in investment, they don't share a single Pro Bowl or a single playoff game among the three of them. I don't know about that. I'm not sure you can sell me that on negativity or positivity or whatever you want to do. I'm not sure they're going to come out of nowhere next year with that bunch.
Do you like the Cowboys defense better?
I like the Cowboys' offense a lot better because it's going to lead the NFL in ball control the way it did 2 years ago. It will control the clock, 40 minutes to 20 minutes. That's what I see.
We done here?
Okay.
Great way to dodge,
yes, we
that,
are.
Dodge that question. All right.
A correct way.
The NFC East up for grabs, as always. There hasn't been a repeat champion the last 11 years. So after losing to the Warriors in the NBA Finals, is LeBron throwing shade Golden State's way? We'll react to the latest after the break.